In this lecture, I will introduce the statistical concept required in functional genomics with an extended focus on those relevant for high-throughput sequencing data analysis. First, let me introduce myself. I'm a researcher at the Swedish University of Agricultural Sciences and the manager of the Umeå Plant Science Center Bioinformatics Facility. I'm a geneticist by training with a Master in Bioinformatics and a PhD in Molecular Genetics obtained at the University of Heidelberg in Germany, where I was working at the German Cancer Research Center on two types of pediatric cancer, analyzing and integrating microarray data. I then worked as a technical officer at the European Molecular Biology Laboratory to establish the analysis of next-generation sequencing data. After that, I moved to Sweden and the UPSC for a postdoc, and since 2016 I have been officially managing the UPSC Bioinformatics Facility. While keeping up with cutting-edge research in the field, I have been involved in teaching that topic since 2009. It is the 8th consecutive year that I'm involved in the functional genomics course. This year is of course different, and even if it is a challenge to do it remotely, it is also extremely exciting. While you will learn about the content, we teachers will learn about the form. In that sense, constructing feedback from you is going to be extremely useful. Back to the topic of this lecture. By the end of the lecture, you will be able to describe the concept of studies design, reflect on the importance of the studies design for an experiment, describe the basic statistical concept necessary for data analysis, revise your interpretation of statistical significance. The format of the lecture will be a mix of videos and exercises, grouped in three blocks. At the end of the lecture, there will be an assessment. This assessment is not graded. The questions there are meant to inform me whether I clearly conveyed my message and to identify any misunderstanding. After I have been through your answers, I will upload my answers as well as any clarification needed in a video format on Canva. To warm up to this lecture format, take 2 minutes to think about the following question. What is gene expression? The next slide of this video will come up in 2 minutes. Meanwhile, just reflect on that question. Think along the lines of 1. What is it? 2. Is it measurable? 3. What would be limitations? Alright, for me, gene expression is the part of a central dogma by which the information in a gene becomes a functional gene product. However, if we think about the methodology used to measure expression, such as RNA-seq, how accurate is that measurement? And how much does it tell us about what the cells were actually doing? My point here is that when you take a sample and snap freeze it, You are recording the amount of mRNA in that sample, consisting of possibly millions of cells in that exact moment. You are therefore averaging the mRNA content of a whole population of cells. Moreover, the fact that an RNA is being transcribed does not imply that it will turn into a functional product. It might be stored, it might be degraded immediately, and so on. So, keep in mind, this I hope demonstrates the first important challenge of data analysis. We need to understand what are the limitations of the tools and methods we have used, and reflect on how it will affect our interpretation of the resulting data. Through that example, it should now be evident that methods such as RNA-seq is but a proxy to gene expression. Having said that, leads me into the importance of study design. To conduct a sound analysis based on robust statistical grounds starts by an adequate study design. In computing science, there's a saying that goes garbage in, garbage out. It expresses the idea that poor quality input will produce faulty output. Hence, the better design your study, the more informative the outcome. The following slides might be a bit boring, but bear with me for the next 6 slides. Study design should be done at the start of a project, based on a sound hypothesis, and involve a discussion with all parties involved. In functional genomics, this often implies to talk with statisticians and computational biologists. Imagine that our research question is about the identification of genes involved in sexual dimorphism, not sexual determination, of European aspen trees. Dimorphism is the difference in morphology. Think about the female-male difference of mammalian species, for example. To address this question, we first need to think about the method to use and about the size of our study. How many of the 40,000 genes in Aspen might be involved in that process? The first question, about the methodology, could be answered by an approach involving RNA sequencing and performing a differential expression analysis between male and female samples. This raises additional questions as to the specific about that method, particularly relevant are the questions that address reproducibility. The second question can be answered by a biologist based on existing knowledge. One would presume, for example, that if there are such genes, there are likely to be few, as sexual determination seems to be a recent event in the evolution of Aspen. Again, this raises technical questions about the study, especially about robustness. All variables are the technical and biological aspects. How does that influence our decision on replication? All these questions lead to further answers from specialists such as bioinformaticians and statisticians, which will inform about the methodology and what is required to achieve a satisfyingly robust, reproducible outcome. Through this discussion, the agreed study design to answer the original question about genes driving sexual dimorphism in European aspen will be as follows. We will use RNA-seq, high depth of sequencing, with as many biological replicates as possible, Monier folding, to perform a differential expression analysis between male and female trees, using appropriate statistical models. Next, this is the first group exercise. Pause this video and watch the linked video. The link is in the Cambro announcement. The video lasts 3.5 minutes. Then take the time, say 10 minutes, to discuss the related issues in your groups, then resume the lecture. As I mentioned previously, the better design your study, the more informative the outcome. An essential aspect is the choice of a model that best represents the data and a good understanding of our assumptions. Let's go through an example to understand better what these concepts are. The following slides are from Patrick Rudin, an associate professor at the Department of Mathematics and Mathematical Statistics at Umeå University. Patrick had the following hypothesis. Can the weight of an animal's brain be explained by its body weight? He downloaded from an online resource the corresponding weights of species classified as animal. He defined X and Y as the body and brain weight, respectively. His first question was then, what is the best approach to model the relationship between X and Y? He could think of different possibilities. However, as a statistician, he knew that 1. All models are wrong. It only models the truth. It is not the truth. 2. We cannot prove that a model is correct, but we can identify faulty models. His first attempt was to assume that there is a linear relationship between X and Y, best model by linear regression. Here is the outcome of his first model. Let's define a few concepts here. On the graph, the X and Y axis represent our variable of interest. The blue dots are the individual data points. The red line is the fitted model. The thin vertical black lines represent the residuals. The residual represent the difference between the observed and predicted Y value. The smaller the residuals, the better the fit of a model. The fit can be summarized as the R-square statistic, which goes from 0 to 1, with 1 being the best possible fit. Patrick's initial model is definitely not good, with an R-square of just 16.6%. So what makes a good model? Essentially, that all of our variables of interest have a significant contribution. But if the model assumptions are correct, we expect the residuals to be normally distributed. This means the variance unaccounted by the model is random. We assume the residuals to be independent of the variables of interest, X and Y in our example. Finally, that the R square is high. On slide 21, most of the data was in the bottom left corner of the plot, so the model was biased by some very heavyweight animals. To control for this, we can transform the data into a logarithmic scale. This is a common transformation in statistics, as it transforms multiplicative errors into additive errors. Log of x by y is the same as log x plus log y. The R-square is now very high, at 83%. However, Patrick noticed that the residuals depend on log x. They increase as log x increase. Including a quadratic term into our model further improves R-square to 87%. But there is an increased variance for the very heavyweight animals. Many have a brain weight considerably smaller than predicted by the model. This is not in line with our assumption, so we better take a closer look at the data. And here it is. Dinosaurs were dumb. More seriously, the animal list contained extinct species. We have made the assumption that we were looking at extant, contemporary, species only. We had an unchallenged assumption, which would have affected our model, especially for the heavyweight animal, certainly influencing our analysis outcome. Plus, it is in itself an interesting observation that dinosaurs, marked in red in the table, had a comparatively smaller brain weight. If we take away these extinct animals, the red dots, the R-square of a simple model, without the quadratic term, is excellent, 95%. This raises an important point. Models can be made to fit the data very well, but they may not be relevant. Such artifacts are called overfitting, and it is important to be aware of such a possibility. Now that we have a model we are satisfied with, what can we use it for? A model can be used, for example, for prediction. Imagine we found the fossil of a recently extinct animal lacking a head. We can still, using our model, estimate what would have been its brain size. We can also use it to understand aspect of biological importance. In the plots on the top left, the red dots are the elephant, Asian and African, both of which have comparatively larger brain than predicted by their body weight. If we think reductively, it is known that elephants are considered very intelligent animals. If we zoom in on the lower part of the graph, the second graph on the right, with animal body weights up to 500 kilos, we can see interesting outliers, such as the grey seal or the koala. If you look for the red dot way out of the graph, indicated by the black arrow, that is us, humans. We are extreme outliers in the animal range when it comes to the brain-body weight ratio. Now that we have seen the importance of the choice of a model and the consequence of unchallenged assumptions, we can move to another important aspect of statistical analysis, the concept of statistical significance. The overall goal of this section is actually to challenge common misinterpretation of statistical significance as it has been abused in the last decades, in particular in the field of biology. This section is an exercise in critical thinking. You will do a couple of group exercises as I described in the Cambro announcement. Remember that group discussion should be inclusive and cordial. There is no right or wrong answers. Also, being able to explain what you understand to others is an important step in the learning process. Make use of it. Before we proceed to our first critical thinking challenge, let's just go through the definition of a p-value, a measure used to report statistical significance. The p-value is the probability of obtaining a test statistic as extreme as the one observed, assuming that the null hypothesis is true. In the graphic that represents the probability distribution of observation according to our model, the p-value is the area in green that sums up all probabilities with a test value at least as extreme as the one we observed. A p-value of 5% means that there is a 5% chance to observe a value as extreme in absence of any real difference. If we do 100 tests, 5 will have an outcome as extreme. This means that we can reject the null hypothesis, assuming a 5% chance that we are wrong doing so. Remember also that we can never accept the null hypothesis. Let's move on to our first challenge. It is about what p-value can actually tell us. As a group, when the next slide shows up, pause the video and discuss about the issue presented in the figure, extracted from Nuzzo et al. This publication is actually a good home read to complement this lecture. Now, pause the video. After a 10-minute discussion, following the instruction in Cambro, resume it. My understanding of this figure is as follows. A p-value tells us the probability of obtaining a test statistic as extreme as the one observed, assuming that the null hypothesis is true. It does not inform us on whether our hypothesis is correct. Nuzzo demonstrated by looking at hypotheses with odds. Here the chance that there is a real effect go from very unlikely to very likely. If our study is well designed, our hypothesis is most probably a good bet, the right column in the graphic, the consequence of which is that the chance that we observe a real effect are high. If the hypothesis is based on a whim, with very little support from existing observations or literature, then the chance of observing a real effect, the left most column, are really small, barely 11%. The issue raised by Nuzzo is a common misconception. Remember that all models are wrong and that we can never accept the null hypothesis. A good model in combination with a good hypothesis are useful. Again, think of a garbage in, garbage out analogy. We have now shaken our understanding of statistical significance a bit. Let's shake it some more and see if there are alternatives. These four papers, which links are in the Cambro announcement, are excellent home reads to complement this lecture. These were raised by scientific worried by the abuse of statistical significance by the scientific community. The communique strip on the right sadly describes a not so uncommon situation. Let's challenge our assumptions. In groups and for about 10 minutes, read extract of the articles on the previous slides. Choose one of the articles. The relevant section per article are described on the present slide. The article links are available in the Cambro announcement. After 10 minutes, for another 10 minutes, write your group observation in the common Google Doc, the link of which is also in the announcement. Now, pause this video and resume in 20 minutes. In the next slides, I will summarize some of the main points of these articles. In the first article, one of the points is to stop categorizing. If a p-value is below a threshold, such as 5%, there is still 5% chance of no effect. Categorizing based on a p-value is hence fraught. Two studies, as in the example on the slide, can have the same effect but different significance. That does not, however, make the studies contradictory. The second article focuses on what p-values are and associated misconception. Again, here is the definition of a p-value. A p-value does not give us any more information than this hypothesis. What is a p-value? A p-value assumes the test hypothesis is true. It indicates the degree to which the data conforms to the model. It comes from a continuous distribution. P equals 0.05 is very different from P being smaller or equal to 0.05. P equals 5% is that exact point in the distribution, while P smaller or equal to 5% is the probability to get as extreme an outcome. P-value have nothing to do with an observed association occurring by chance alone. This would mean that all assumptions and the tested hypothesis are true. P-value cannot be used to accept or reject, for that matter, the null hypothesis. See article number one. P-value are no indication of an effect or its size. This is very important. A very small effect can be highly significant, but hardly relevant at all to the study. P-value have nothing to do with a false positive rate. Article number three raises another important misconception about statistical significance. We should not summarize by statistical significance. Imagine three studies, as represented in the table, describing the effect of a drug on a clinical condition. Are study A and B, or A and C, showing any significant difference? Naively, if we look at A versus B, we would say yes, one is significant, the other one is not. But actually, if we look at the effect estimation and the standard error, SE, the difference in effect is 15 plus minus 14. So there is no difference. If we look at A and C, we would say, no, they are both significant. But actually, they are very different. The effect size shows a tenfold difference. Now, imagine that we are scientists and give the following table to a panel deciding which drug should be put on the market. What would the panel do? Probably take the same naive approach as we would have and choose A over B, which we know makes no difference. So we need to rethink how we present statistical significance. That's where the fourth article is interesting. It shows alternatives of an experiment with a set of matched control and sample treatment, C and T, with about 30 measurements per condition. Panel A is a common representation. A bar plot with a single summary value per condition, a simple asterisk describing the statistical significance, and minimalistic error bars. This excels at promoting categorization and summarization. Panel B already improves. Instead of single summary values, it displays box plots presenting the data distribution and the p-value as an actual number range. Panel C further improves on this by showing the actual data points and p-value. Here, it becomes evident that the control in blue has an average lower value, but that a subpopulation of it has a very high value, higher than most treatment. If you think about the previous examples of Article 3, this would mean that only a subpopulation would be responsive to the treatment, which is an information of high value. Panel D is even more informative. The plot is centered on the data. It does not go all the way to zero. And on the right, it displays the distribution of difference between the matched samples. In red is the area covered by the p-value shown. This plot is very informative, as it makes clear that as many as 8 blue dots, controls, are at or above the p-value cutoff. Basically, 26% of the data points in the controls have an effect as extreme as induced by the treatment. Finally, Panel E takes the focus away from the statistical significance and focus on the effect size distribution and its corresponding confidence interval. If we were looking at a drug, this will tell us about the average effect size to expect. And if you look at the red bar, it would mean that only a negligible amount of patients would not react to the drug, the amount in the area below that red bar. What are the advantages of using graphical representations such as described in paper number 4? First, all data points are visible. Second, the difference is visualized as a distribution which prevents categorization. Third, the focus is moved from statistical significance, giving us information about the effect size and its confidence interval. In other words, it helps putting statistical significance in the right perspective and helps thinking quantitatively. We have now reached the end of the lecture. I thank you for your attention. You should now be able to describe the concept of study design, reflect on the importance of the study design for an experiment, describe the basic statistical concept necessary for data analysis, and revise your interpretation of statistical significance. As mentioned in the Cambro announcement, please log in now in Socrative and give me feedback about the lecture. Also, the last 5 questions will be very useful for me to assess how well I conveyed my message. I will later, during the day, upload my answers about these 5 questions.